Dear friends, first I would like to apologize that I was not able to join you in person. I'm just now traveling by car from Slovenia to Brussels and, as you could guess, it is the whole day drive. Thank you for hosting this seminar on the work of the International Resource Panel, IRP for short, and its connections to the work of the Ministry of Environment in Finland, and also for inviting me to speak. You asked me to address the core issues and current approaches of the IRP, and I'm happy to do so. I will introduce the IRP, then talk about how its work can contribute to mitigating climate change and reversing biodiversity loss. But let me start with a brief introduction to the IRP, which I co-chair with Isabella Teixeira. The IRP is a science-based policy interface hosted by UNEP since 2007. It is a sister organization to IPCC and IPBS, maybe known better to many of you. It brings together about 40 scientists from all parts of the world to consolidate knowledge and produce new insights on the management of natural resources, its impacts and solutions. It is steered by around 35 countries, including Finland and the European Commission. It is a lean panel, but very productive. Why is looking at natural resource flows such a useful lens in understanding underlying causes of the many challenges we face? Because natural resources are the bridge between economy and competitiveness on the one hand, and climate change, biodiversity loss, pollution, and health implications on the other. Global natural resource extraction has tripled since 1970, now being at over 90 billion tons per year, with the world's wealthiest countries consuming the most. There are serious environmental consequences. The extraction and processing of natural resources causes 50% of global climate change, mainly due to the production of fossil fuel products, biomass, steel, and cement. They also cause 90% of the global land-related biodiversity loss, mainly due to biomass production in agriculture, timber production, or ocean resource use. Natural resource industries also cause 1/3 of the global air pollution, as well as water and land pollution, for example, in coal or steel industries. According to IRP estimates, without drastic changes, global resource consumption is predicted to double by 2060. Such a growth in resource use would not only be catastrophic for climate and biodiversity, it would also be detrimental to global fairness, as resources are being used much faster by high-income countries and the impacts are mainly hitting the poorest. While we strive to improve our well-being, we must reduce the need for additional virgin natural resources as much as we can. That is to say, we must decouple well-being and economic growth from natural resource use and environmental impacts. So, natural resource use drives planetary crises, but it can also be a crucial part of the solution. You asked about the current approaches of the IRP. System thinking is key. Conceptualizing natural resource use in the context of broader societal trends and analyzing trade-offs and co-benefits of potential solutions. For example, imagine the trade-offs if we power all future material production with clean energy without reducing increasing demand for products, additional land needs, demand for rare materials, new mines opened, all with environmental consequences. By applying system thinking, we can design solutions which improve the actual purpose of the production. For example, a large proportion of industrial emissions are related to the production of steel and cement. Much of that steel goes into underutilized cars, inefficiently built cities, or underutilized and under-maintained machinery. To eliminate industry emissions, we do indeed need to clean up production processes, but we also need to be smarter in the use of the industrial products and services. IRP logic tells us that we need to design systems of mobility, housing, consumer goods, and food smarter, so that they provide societal function much more efficiently. While I'm speaking of solutions for climate, let me highlight a recent IRP report on resource efficiency for climate change. This report points towards the considerable contribution that changing patterns of utilization, as well as making the material use embedded in their production circular, would make to reducing carbon emissions. It is focusing on cars and buildings. For example, building residential space to be used more intensively could have a big impact. In the world's richest countries, material efficiency strategies, including reduced floor space and use of recycled building materials, could reduce emissions across the whole building life cycle up to 40% by 2050. The way we utilize vehicles could also make a substantial difference. Ride sharing and car sharing would reduce the total number of vehicles needed to meet travel demand, leading to a reduced car manufacturing footprint, as well as a reduced utilization footprint. If by 2060, 25% of car trips in G7 countries were shared journeys in shared vehicles, emissions across the whole vehicle life cycle could be reduced by almost 20%. This would contribute to public health through reducing pollution as well as to mitigating climate change. This is the kind of evidence which points to the need to change our socially embedded expectations about use of resources and space. Policies incentivizing increasing building use intensity, such as relaxing single-family zoning, encouraging public transport and ride sharing, for example, by reserving part of the road for shared rides, can enable the transition we need. Such solutions also bring co-benefits. If you build an efficient, shared, and circular transport system, you will not only reduce transport emissions and improve public health, but save tons of steel for private cars, require fewer batteries and critical raw materials, and even free the land. Let me turn now to the planetary crisis of biodiversity loss. I know it is a priority for the government of Finland, and rightly so. With over 80 countries committing to reverse biodiversity loss by 2030 through signing the Leaders' Pledge for Nature, and with COP15 in Kunming this year setting new global biodiversity targets, we have a huge opportunity to deliver real change for nature. To be truly effective, future actions need to be focused on the root causes of biodiversity loss, in addition to conservation. The drivers for biodiversity loss are the demand for food, timber, and other natural resource materials, as well as the pollution caused by their extraction and use. Of course, we all need food and wood, but that is not really the problem. The problem is that this demand is currently provided by incredibly inefficient and linear systems. Most biodiversity discussions still mainly discuss how to marginally increase conservation areas, instead of how to change the underlying causes of linear and inefficient food and land management. My co-chair Isabella Teixeira and I were actively involved in negotiating the Aichi targets in Nagoya in 2010. 20 biodiversity goals we committed to as a global community. The sad fact is that after more than a decade, none of them have been in reality met. This is the reason why we contributed a new IRP opinion piece, Building Biodiversity, the Natural Resource Management Approach. It looks at biodiversity governance through a natural resource use lens and highlights principles which policymakers can put into practice for effective implementation of the next set of targets. These principles are knowing your impact, planning together, growing with nature, and valuing nature. Knowing your impact is essentially the principle of value chain transparency. Every sector and every consumer must understand why and how they have an impact on nature. This transparency would enable decision makers to identify key points of intervention, where environmental impacts along the value chain caused by production and consumption can be reduced. Transparency can also incentivize investments in sustainable production activities. Ideally, policymakers would act to make value chain transparency a reality through strong scientific data and consistent international standards. A major contributor to the over-exploitation of natural resources which drive biodiversity loss is the fact that countries have incomplete pictures of how their natural resources are being used and how their uses impact each other. Planning together, integrated landscape planning, it's essential to gain the necessary full picture of competing spatial needs. Policymakers should make it mandatory for such integrated land use maps to be part of countries' national climate and biodiversity plans. Growing with nature. Scaling nature-based and circular solutions offers huge economic and environmental opportunities, including restoring degraded landscapes and job creation. For example, planting bamboo created a solid amount of jobs in Tanzania. Policymakers have an important role to play in incentivizing the circular bioeconomy and embracing the restoration and livelihood creation opportunities it presents. The final principle, valuing nature, is deeply needed because the intrinsic value of natural assets and the services they provide is not recognized by economic systems. This contributes to the mismanagement of natural resources. The Dasgupta Review, published earlier this year, highlights institutional failure and the failure of contemporary economics to acknowledge that we are embedded in and not external to nature, and to act accordingly. It makes the case for basing economic decisions on an inclusive measure of wealth based on human, produced, and natural capital. Policymakers need to find ways of integrating ecosystem extent and quality into central government decisions by improving international capacity for natural capital accounting, for example. In short, redefining consumption from owning to using, redefining production from mass sales to providing efficient functionalities, and redefining core economic incentives such as taxation and subsidies while showing the desirability of such shifts in pilot programs. In the IRP, we are committed to showing how natural resource management influences many other policy areas. For example, the global distribution of natural resources has consequences for human mobility and migration, currently being analyzed for a new IRP publication in preparation for next year adoption. In the next edition of our flagship report, The Global Resource Outlook, to be published in 2023, we will show the central role of resource use management in economic system transformation. This knowledge should help decision makers focus action on the root causes of environmental and social crises and implement systemic measures to tackle them. Dear friends, thank you again for hosting this seminar. IRP will continue to benefit from Finland's valuable inputs and active role you play in our work. I wish you a fruitful and enjoyable day.